What's going on? What's going on? This is your boy, J. Will, your host of the J. Will Interviews and podcast commentary. I have on the line with me right now, coming to the stage, is Jamal Morgan. What's going on, sir?
Not much. How you doing, Jay?
I'm good, man. Good, man. Glad to have you on, man. I wanted to do a little something a little different. Wanted to get some young blood on here, young man, young entrepreneur, to talk about how he grinded in the world.
Yes, sir. Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. You can support the J. Will podcast interviews and commentary by clicking on the donate button on the homepage, or you can cash app me via $ J. Will podcast on Cash App. All the monies will be used to support the podcast mission, along with the radio shows that I'm doing on itsallgospelradio.com. I have the J. Will Gospel Show, and I have the Unsigned Artist Gospel Show. And also, I have a podcast platform on Anointed Radio Network, the Anointed Radio Network with Pastor J. Line. What's up, J. Line? All right. So, Brother Morgan, how are you, man? Did I lose your audio?
Okay, there it is.
Okay, there we go. All right. So you doing okay tonight, man?
Yes, sir, I am.
Good, good. Tell the people where you're from, sir.
So I am originally from Cincinnati, Ohio.
Okay. So how long you been in Cincinnati?
My whole life. I'm 29, so haven't been here very long.
Well, some people might say that ain't a long time, but 29 years in one place, man, that's a long time.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So I assume you graduated high school, et cetera, in Cincinnati.
Yes, yes. I graduated at Cincinnati College Prep here in Cincinnati, and then I went to Cincinnati State for culinary arts.
Okay, okay. So I understand you have a couple of occupations.
Yes, sir.
So describe those occupations.
So my main job, I'm a manager at a home healthcare agency. So I take time through my day to manage homes. I go around and make sure all of my supervisors are up to code, that their paperwork is correct, and, you know, that they're following all the state rules with everything that's appointed to us. And then I'm also a private chef. So I do catering events. I do private dinners. I do intimate settings, and I also do teachings. So anyone who is not very well vexed in the kitchen, I can get you up to speed.
Wow. So while we're on that subject, tell the people your email address so they can contact you if they need some chef lessons.
Yes. So my email address is Jamal Morgan. That's J-A-M-A-L Morgan at ymail.com. And it's just the letter Y.
Okay. Y'all got that, ladies and gentlemen. So how long have you been in the healthcare field?
So I started in the healthcare field about 2018. So going into a little over, I believe that's 6 years now.
Wow. So what pushed you in the direction of the healthcare field?
So the healthcare field, I've always been interested in. I always joke with my family that I think I was supposed to be a cardiologist. Oh. I was diagnosed very early with a heart disease that they usually see in 70 and 80 year old men. So it always intrigued me, the heart and the body. And it made me want to go into healthcare. So I started as a home health agent, and I worked my way up to manager of the company within a few years.
Wow. Wow. So, you know, you still have time to go back to college and be a cardiologist.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So don't take that off the table.
Yes, sir.
So what type of home care, home health services do you provide?
So myself personally, when I go to an individual's home to help care for them, we do medication passes. We get them integrated into the community, into their own community as well, to meet new people, make friends. I teach everyone that I work with how to cook, from just the smallest of making a sandwich to making steak if they're comfortable enough with it. I'll teach them knife skills and things, just getting them worked into the kitchen and out into the community so that they are able to live the most what we would consider normal life possible.
Yeah, yeah. So how would you, you know, kind of quantify your experience with doing that? Is it rewarding? Is it challenging? Is it not rewarding?
So it's a little of both.
Yeah.
It is challenging because it's new for me. I'm used to being in a kitchen. So that's my thing, is working kitchens, and I do a little construction. So I'm used to not dealing directly with people all the time and just making sure things in the back end are taken care of. And now dealing directly with others, it's very rewarding to see someone who has been determined to not be able to do something and see myself help them do that. And I'm also a track coach as well at two high schools. So
oh, wow.
My coaching feeds into my helping with the individuals that we provide care for.
Wow. So you're doing track on the side with high schoolers?
Yes. Yes. I do shot put discus for 7th to 12th grade.
Hey, you know there's a special reward in heaven for you dealing with them high school kids, man.
Now that I do believe.
Hey, man, it's a totally different, you know, different day, man, than when I was growing up.
That it is.
Certainly, I mean, you can see the difference between the way you grew up and the way you were groomed to be a teenager. It's a lot different, man. These kids. Not all kids. I can't generalize, but you have a lot of kids that simply just don't care.
Yes, I agree.
So you know, with you dealing with the clients that you deal with in home health, and seeing how they're trying to manage with just simple life skills, and you pouring into them, and they want to do more, and sometimes, the impairments that they have will not allow them. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with the fact that you're dealing with normal, healthy teenagers that sometimes don't want to receive the knowledge and work the full capacity that they're blessed with?
Okay. So it's a little frustrating because I know for myself, when I was coming through high school, we had a lot of people in school with a lot of talents. I wasn't the most talented, but I put my best foot forward always. So yeah. I can recognize natural talent. So when I see the kids who I know can go very far and they have a passion, but because they're distracted, it becomes a little frustrating. So my approach is more of a friend/father figure. And I kind of remind them of where the road that they're going down will end. And yeah. Then the places that they can go if they just apply themselves. So sometimes I'll show them my own pay stubs, or I'll show them my budgets and things, just to show them real life instances of this is like, just because we're throwing and we are practicing footwork, that doesn't mean you can't continue to apply it to other parts of your life. So I show them different ways to apply the knowledge in theory to different parts of life. And when they're able to put everything together where A and B actually equal C for them, then they start to understand. And it's quite rewarding by the end of the season, because the kid that you saw at the beginning is a totally different person by the end of the season.
So, man, you like the modern day life coach.
Yes, sir.
Because what you just described to me, man, I know some adults that need that kind of teaching. You know,
I know a lot.
Yes, sir. I can imagine it's pretty rewarding, though, to see the transitions and just the mental aspect of the teenager, and seeing them develop psychologically over the season, man.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, just as a disclosure, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not saying all kids are bad, but we do got some bad kids out here, and I guess I want to ask this question. Why do you think it's so challenging for teenagers now, since you're in the school system, working with those folks, why is it so challenging for them to understand that educational growth and the work growth, the work ethic growth is so important these days?
So the one thing that I've noticed is social media. Social media is a wonderful thing, but it has been the downfall for a lot of younger children's mindset, because when you see someone who is telling you, hey, you should be a lawyer, you should be a doctor, you should be a surgeon, you should do something that you can add into society, and then you go online and you see a TikToker or a podcaster who can go and buy 9 cars and drop bricks on them just for fun. Let's see how far of the windshield, how much of the windshield will break with this brick fall on it. So they see that, and it shows nothing as far as education is concerned, nothing as far as going to school and furthering yourself, but more of get in front of a camera, do something silly, and make tons of money. So it's a distraction, and they don't realize that there's no longevity. So they think when they see those things, oh, they made $10 million. Well, you can blow $10 million in a year if you're determined. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But if you have a $500,000 or $600,000 salary, you're good, and you have longevity, and you have something under your belt that you can always use. No matter where you move to, you use that degree, you use that those skills, you use the certificates that you earn, and things that are under your belt as accolades to move forward. So I really do believe that when they see the fast money and they see the big name streamers and TikTokers and video game players, they automatically assume, well, I can do that and I don't have to apply myself anymore. And I think that's where the challenge is coming from.
Man, and, you know, you said something really important there, because I see 8-year-olds walking around with smartphones, and they never look up, and they're always on their smartphones, you know, looking at TikTok videos, like you say. And social media is a good thing. I use social media to advertise my shows, but I sometimes I see a whole bunch of nonsense, you know. And if you get caught up in the nonsense, we all know that the child's mind is not as fully developed as an adult mind. But it's even kind of hard to say that anymore, because I'm seeing some adult minds that are not developed either. You know what I'm saying? Like, like, why would you post certain stuff? You know, it's just the time is different. I was at the UDF this morning, and I was getting ready to walk in the store, and there was a young lady. She could have been like 18 or 19 years old. And I was taught, you know, if a woman's walking, you know, in front of you or behind you, you open the door for her. So I opened the door and I stood and I waited. I was waiting on her to walk through the door. And her response was, oh, I don't need you to open the door for me. Mm-hmm. And I was like, and before I knew it, I was like, well, wow. I'm trying to be nice to you, but obviously you're not intelligent enough to receive the niceness. And I said it before I knew it, because it frustrated me. But this is the way this thing is running. And I think that they're seeing all these things on social media, all these negative things of how men are, which is not who all men are, but just the mindset of, I don't want you to open a door for me and respect me as a lady. But, you know, that's what social media has done to some of our folks.
I agree.
Yeah. So you're in the finance as well, right?
Yes, sir.
So what do you do as far as finances?
So in finance, I'm a life insurance agent. So I get people set up with the right life insurance, because there's a lot of life insurance out there. And I was one of those people who believed if I saw it on TikTok and there were 2 or 3 million people liking videos and a couple hundred thousand comments, that might be the best way to go. So I decided, let me go out to a couple companies and apply. Let's apply to be an agent. Let's figure out what it is that they teach their agents. And I started learning little things. So I sell life insurance. We do investments with our company as well. So we'll teach you how to invest properly, where you don't have to invest money and watch the stock market. You'll invest money monthly, and a professional who is licensed will watch the market and move the money around as it needs to be moved, putting it in stocks and bonds and CDs and different things of that sort. And I'm also a financial coach. So if you have any debt issues, any spending problems, budgeting issues, anything of the sort, I can also help with those as well.
You know, man, I mean, you're such a young man, but you have a lot going on. But let's dive into more of this financial coaching thing here. So if people are in budget, you know, have a budget malfunction in their finances, you sit down with them and you consult with them on how to maintain a budget or set up a budget?
Yes, yes. So we'll sit down and assess what your needs are, see where the excessive spending is, if there is, see where your income sits, and kind of map out a way to budget your money and to get out of whatever maybe financial hold you might be in, so that you can have financial freedom in the near future. Because there are people who will tell you, well, you can have financial freedom, but that would be in 30, 40, 50 years. It's my job to make sure you get financial freedom in a reasonable time, near future, so that you can live comfortably going forward.
Okay. So you sit down with them and you do what you would call a debt to income ratio?
Yes, sir.
And see where the excessive spending is coming in at, and kind of budget around what the income of the household is.
Correct.
Yeah. You know, so I know a lot of people who don't think that $4 here, $3 here adds up. You know, when you get that paycheck and you're like, man, I got all this money, but you don't basically nickel and dime yourself for 2 weeks or a month. Mm-hmm. And you help people get set up to where they can, you know, manage their money wisely.
Yes. Where they can, and they can feel good about their money decisions. Because a lot of times we do feel good when the paycheck comes, and then you get paid Friday and Monday rolls around and you have $18 left to last you for another 10 days or to last you for another 5 days until the next check comes. And what I've noticed with a lot of people, and this is ranging from age, I've worked with 18 up to 40, 50, 60 years old. There are people who they're basically chronic spenders. They have their mindset on something that they like, they purchase it, and then because they know there's another check coming in a week or in 2 weeks, they'll spend it anyways. Even though they know it's not a good idea, well, I know it's more money coming, so let's go ahead and throw that out. And then when you ask them, because one of my good questions is, can you handle a $500 emergency? Most people who are chronic spenders can't. And I'll ask them even lower, can you handle a $200 emergency? No, I wouldn't be able to. I wouldn't be able to change my car's battery. But I make, and I've had someone who made over 150 grand a year and couldn't scrape up $500.
Wow.
Because of chronic spending.
Man, I tell you what, you can pay now, pay later.
Yes, sir.
You know, because I like to save. You know what I'm saying? Only because I'm getting older now. Mm-hmm. And I want to save to a point to where if I want to buy something, I can go buy it and not have to sacrifice something that's really important. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Like I've seen people go buy a $200 purse and not have money to pay their light bill.
Yes, sir.
And that's, sure. You know, that's the kind of stuff you help out with.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
So is it hard to get people to transition from being a responsible steward over their finances?
It is, depending on where that person is. What I've noticed is people who are fresh in, younger most of the time, but people who are fresh into saving and putting money away, since they know there's more coming, or they feel like, hey, I'm only 25, I got 40 more years, I'll be okay. Those are the ones that it takes the most time and the most consistency with. I'd have to call them just to see when I know, hey, this person on Tuesdays is going to go and spend. I'll call them on Tuesday. Hey, how's saving going today? Did you spend any money? Did you put anything up? Well, I didn't. Or they'll avoid the phone calls. So those are the people that it's the most difficult. But then you have those who know that, hey, if I continue where I'm going now, I'm going to work forever. I'll never retire. I'll never have anything in the bank. And when I'm on a walker, when I'm on a cane, or when I would just like to be at home relaxing with my family, grandchildren, I have to go to work 40 plus hours a week because of the bad decisions. Those people, takes a little time, but it's a lot easier to get them to understand the concept.
You know, man, that's pretty incredible. So you're not just, I'm going to sit behind the table and tell you what you need to do. You actually are trying to hold them accountable.
Yes, absolutely.
Hey, that's pretty admirable, because I don't know any financial institutions or financial gurus that will call people and say, hey, bro, did you put some money into savings today? Wow. So let me ask this question. Have you seen like an impact on people's finances and what they're able to do since there's been so many transitions in the economy lately?
I actually have, yes. I've seen a few people who were able to pay off vehicles. Yeah. I've had a few who had credit card issues where we went through, which most financial institutions will teach you the debt snowballing method with credit cards. And you don't realize that you have five credit cards and you put your minimum payment down, but then you put something extra on top. But when you start to pay those off, you start to realize you have an extra $700, $800, $900 a month that you were just throwing away at interest only. Yeah. And then when you have that additional money with no credit card debt, I've watched someone pay a car off in half the time that they thought they would be able to, just because I didn't realize I have this much more money with none of this credit card debt.
Yeah.
So it impacts credit scores increasing. They're paying off cars faster. They're even planning to pay off mortgages in half the time, signing up for 30 years and being able to pay off in 15.
Yeah. Yeah, that's incredible. So, and let's go back to the chef thing.
Okay.
Obviously, you like cooking. You mentioned that before.
Yes, sir.
What's your favorite dish?
I actually no longer have one. So prior to culinary school, my favorite dish was chicken parmesan. I made it all the time. I started cooking when I was 11.
Okay. So
my first meal I made when I was 11 was homemade fries and chicken nuggets, and it was the most disgusting thing you've ever ate in your life. And from that day forward, I knew I had to be a chef.
Man.
Yeah. So now, since culinary school, we did a lot of French training. So my traditional meats that I may eat before school, now I'll try almost anything. I've had duck liver and rabbit and goose. And there's literally an endless list of things that I've eaten now that I like to cook now. So I no longer have a favorite dish, but I do have a favorite cuisine, and that would be Caribbean.
Oh, okay. Man, for a second there, you started sounding like you was from the South. You're talking about eating rabbit and duck. Oh, man. So, I'm glad that you're so successful in what you're doing. If you were going to give, some young people, young men, some advice, what would you tell them?
So some advice to some young people. Learn about money early. Learn how to budget and use a bank account for savings. And not for all savings, but still use it for savings to apply yourself. When you're not especially if you're in school, when you're not confident with something or you're not very sure of your answers, always ask questions. That's the one thing as an adult that I know I took from school and I use it every day. If I don't understand, I'm going to ask questions. I will not let something go past without me asking a question. I don't care how dumb I think it is, how dumb someone tells me it is, or how it looks.
Right,
always
right.
Ask questions. And my motto in life, I like to learn from other people's mistakes. If you've gone down that road and you can tell me where it leads, I don't need to go down that road and find out too. So learn from your elders. Talk to people who are older than you, people who are where you want to be, and learn from their mistakes and keep a mentor. If you can find a mentor that's at least 15, 20 years older than you, get with that mentor and learn. Just be willing to learn. Listen twice as much as you talk and just learn. And remember that you can never stop learning.
So, I mean, again, you're such a young fellow. But before I get into this next question, go ahead and shoot the people your email address one more time.
Okay. So email address is Jamal Morgan, J-A-M-A-L, Morgan, @ymail.com. And it's just the letter Y.
So if you need culinary experience or you need to learn how to cook, you know, I don't know, maybe your wife don't cook that well. Jamal can tell you with his expertise, with his palate, how to season the food correctly. If you need a life coach, if you need help with your finances, email Jamal. He'll talk to you. He's a nice brother. I can just tell by, you know, the way he's carrying himself. He's not a rusty guy. He's polished. If you need, you know, information on getting your loved one involved in home health care, he's a manager. He can help you out with that. And so shoot him an email and talk to him. But now I want to go back. I know everything has not been, you know, peaches and cream on your journey. What have you gone through in life to keep you driving, to keep you pushing, or what things have you gone through to set you back?
Gotcha. Okay. So my biggest setback in life, fresh out of high school, I went to prom, and the next morning from prom, me and my best friend, we went to White Castle to get breakfast. We come back to our hotel room and I wake up on the floor. I have three paramedics sitting on top of me and I'm yelling for them to get off. And until I felt the hand of my best friend's mother, who is a mother figure to me, I finally calmed myself down when I felt that. And she assured me that I was okay because I didn't know what happened. I didn't know what was going on. So I go to the hospital to find out I had a syncopal episode, passed out. So, okay, fine. This was in May of 2014. So in October of 2014, I'm working at a Bengals game. The only thing I remember is passing a customer a Coca-Cola, and I woke up on the floor again, paramedics holding me down. This time there's blood everywhere, and I'm not sure what happened. So finally get to the hospital. My lip here is split all the way open. My two front teeth are busted out. I fell face first on the concrete. So they did more tests. They said another syncopal episode, but because they couldn't figure it out, they called it a seizure. So we assumed, okay, I must have epilepsy. So we went and did a lot of testing. So for that next year and a half, we did so much testing that I had about $800,000 in medical bills.
Wow.
That's how much testing that was done. And after that second pass out, I was bedridden for 6 months. So I was to not have a phone, a television, contact with light because my equilibrium was completely off. I was not allowed to drive a vehicle. So I had to sit in a dark room for 6 months straight. So I had to deal with depression. Yes, it was a lot. So I had to deal with depression, I had to deal with suicidal thoughts. I had to deal with not feeling wanted, not feeling needed anymore, because I love when people, I can help someone else. Whenever I can help someone else, I feel great. And I was not able to help other people. I was not able to get help. So I was helpless in a sense. And because of that, it made me deepen my walk with Christ. I prayed about it, and I was actually in. So when that second pass out happened, I was in college my first time. So for the first time, I went in 2014. I had to drop out. So I had to drop all my classes. I was left with the bill for all the classes. And we just prayed about it. We sent in emails to professors and to the deans, and they finally wiped all of my bills clean. So I didn't have to pay any of those medical bills, or I'm sorry, any of those bills from college. And because of me being determined, even though I was out of it, I could barely stand. If I stood up, I felt like I was in a boat on water, just moving. And because I was determined, I re-enrolled myself in college. I was not cleared at all. I wasn't even supposed to be driving, but I couldn't sit around and allow myself to drop into a deeper and deeper depression. So I re-enrolled in college. I started working downtown at the Millennium Hotel. And it just, from there forward, I started taking care of myself better. I never drank, never smoked, never did any drugs, anything of the sort. So none of this came from any of that. But I made sure I stayed clean. I ate clean. I worked out 3 to 4 times a day. When I was in high school, I ran cross country and track. So I was always running. So my body was always healthy. And that's what threw all of this off, is where did this come from? The heart disease that I spoke of, it's atrial fibrillation. So they told me that in about 2016. So I woke up one day and my heart was beating so fast, I had to record it on my Apple Watch. So I recorded it, and it said I was at 350 beats a minute.
Dang.
And it felt like something was trying to jump out of my chest. So we went to the hospital, and that's when they diagnosed me. They had to put 2 patches on my chest and back and shock my heart back into a normal rhythm. So through the time of graduating high school to now, I've had a countless number of health scares and things that could have taken me out. And I realized, okay, I could have been gone already. At 18 years old, I could have been gone. But because that wasn't God's plan, but it was an opportunity for me to get closer to God, because as I look back on that time, I was drifting away. I was doing things that I had no business doing, going in directions that I shouldn't have been. And God brought me back in. And unfortunately, it was an extreme way, in my opinion. It was extreme, but it's all in God's plan and it's all in his timing. So once I got myself together and I kept going forward, I just always remind myself that, hey, you could be bedridden. You could be in the hospital right now. You could be gone now. There could be a lot of different things that's wrong, but because I stayed determined and I stayed prayed up, that's what keeps me going forward.
Man, I can't imagine having to lay in the bed with no TV, no sunlight, no radio, no cell phone. You just laying there.
Yes.
Man, I mean, how did you deal with that part of it? Just knowing that you really couldn't function at full capacity, but just had to just lay there.
It was tough. So I did try and read my word. Sometimes reading, everything got blurry and the pages moved a lot. So sometimes I couldn't read it, but I would listen to the word. I would listen to different pastors on podcasts, or the ones that just record their sermons, and I would listen to their sermons and play my gospel music, and or I just play jazz music, play instruments and things, and just find different ways to keep my mind occupied, because I couldn't expect a family member to sit in a room with me all day. Everybody had to go to work. They had children to take care of. So I took that time to reflect, to take on self-care, and to just think about, if I have this opportunity placed back in front of me, what am I going to do with it?
You know, ladies and gentlemen, hearing everything that Jamal's went through then and where he is now, we literally have no excuses for failing. We have no excuses. I mean, he had every reason to say, okay, this is just the way my life's going to be. I won't be at the house just chilling. I can't drive. I can't work. I can't do this. But instead, he decided to pick himself up and says, I can't do this. I can't live like this. And he did something about it. And that's very commendable. So, ladies and gentlemen, we don't have any excuses as to why we should not be doing anything. Get up and do something. Jamal's offered his services to help you learn how to cook. Learn how to cook, start a catering business, do something, but just don't settle, you know. And the doctors may say one thing, but God can say something totally different. And before you know it, you'll be up on your feet like Jamal. Man, what a powerful testimony, bro.
Thank you.
And you still got a long way to go, too, man. You still young, just 29. Let me see. I can't even remember when I was 29. Oh man, I got gray hair popping out all in my beard and stuff. Your beard's still black. I'm kind of jealous of that, by the way. Yeah, black beard. I was dying for a while, but you know, might as well let the gray pop on out, sir. They call it something. Somebody called me a silver fox the other day. I said, no, man, I'm a possum. I want to be a silver possum. You know what I'm saying? Oh man. But anyway, I appreciate your time, sir. And you know how to get in touch with me if you need me. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, don't forget to check out the J Will Podcast interviews and commentary on RSS.com. And you can also find me on Anointed Radio, the Anointed Radio Network. Podcast. Also, I'm on It's All Gospel, Sunday through Friday, with the J. Will Gospel Show and the Unsigned Artist Gospel Show. And my time slot just got increased with that. Remember, if you want to support the podcast, you can do so by $ J. Will Podcast on Cash App, or find the donate button located on the J. Will Podcast interview and commentary home screen. And just go ahead and donate. All of your finances are going to help me to be able to continue to do what I do. And don't forget to hit up Jamal. He already said his email. Go ahead and contact him. And then if you look under the description of the podcast, his information will be down there so you can contact him as well. Are you on social media?
I am, yes. I'm on Instagram. I have my chef page is on Instagram, actually.
Okay. I will get all the information. All right, your boy J. Will, your host of the J. Will Podcast Interviews and Commentary. If you'd like to donate, please do so by $ J. Will Podcast on Cash App, or on the home screen, RSS.com, J. Will Podcast Interviews and Commentary. Find the donate feature, and you may donate that way. This podcast has been brought to you by Chris Crane and Charlie's Music Factory. For all your production needs, contact Mr. Chris Crane at charliesmusicfactory@gmail.com. All right, may the Lord God bless and keep you. Oh, wait a minute. Follow my music page, James Williams Music. That way you can see all my updates of what I'm doing. You can see all of my show updates for my syndicated radio show, which airs on itsallgospelradio.com. I'm on 4 p.m. Pacific Time, 6 p.m. Central Time, and 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And immediately following those times, the J. Will Daily Show comes on. So you can get your whole music, gospel, loving life together by listening to one of the J. Will radio episodes, the Unsigned Artist Gospel Show, and the J. Will Gospel Show, and the J. Will Daily Show. All right. shoot me an email at leewill@gmail.com. That's leewill@gmail.com. If you have a small business, or you have a music production business, or you have some special commentary you'd like to talk about, hit me an email. I'd love to have you on the podcast. And remember, may the Lord God bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, and may the Lord God give you peace.